good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. Does not matter what time of night or day, I'm still just as happy that you stopped by my channel. Many thanks to you. If we're meeting for the first time, my name's Reverend Paul J. Bern. I'm the online pastor of the online church known as the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center, based in Atlanta, Georgia, sending blog posts and videos around the world, and books too. And books too. This is not an ordinary church. This is online only. You will find no brick and mortar here. We don't teach one particular religion here, except for Christianity. We don't teach any of the denominational stuff. No political ideologies will be found here either. The only thing that can be found and will be found is Jesus Christ, crucified, died, and resurrected on the morning of the third day of that truly magnificent morning. Seated now at his Father's right hand, waiting for the time to take us home, to come and get us. Glory be to you, O Lord. Praise your holy name, Christ Jesus. Praise you forever. Now, for today's message, the title is going to be The Flip Side of the Teachings of Christ. As there are two sides to every coin, you see, so it is with the teachings of Christ Jesus. Give me just a few minutes here to explain this. This is educational and enriching, frankly. I want people to be enriched by the message I'm delivering today. Now, for this week's Sunday message, I will once again, but from a different angle, demonstrate that the teachings and presence of the Lord in spirit and in truth are more relevant today than ever before. I'm not talking about religion, nor about doctrine. I'm just writing today, or recording today, about Jesus Christ and what he taught us. Because people everywhere seem to be hungry and thirsty for some real truth and authenticity. So today I am once again putting Jesus up on the pedestal where he belongs. My topic is what we now will call the Beatitudes of Christ, or just the Beatitudes for short. I'm going to give you two different sets of quotes about this. The first one from the Apostle Matthew, his gospel, and the second from Luke's. These are very powerful instructions from our Lord and Savior. So let's examine what happens when we obey them, followed by what can happen if we don't. So let me begin with Matthew chapter 5 and verse 2, which will be the majority of our scriptural verses for this week's message. And I quote, he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God." Excuse me for a moment. "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you When people insult you, persecute you, and say all kinds of evil against you because of me, rejoice and be glad, said our Lord, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way, they persecuted the prophets who came before you. Now that's a close quote, by the way. That's Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 through 12. Where that bit of scripture came from. That bit of pure truth. Now, let's take that and put it all into context. The term poor in spirit could mean a couple of things. Because those who are dispirited and disenfranchised and disillusioned, and there are a lot of us out there right now, it could also mean people who are mentally depressed. Depression is a real mental illness. It is not something to be played around with either. It can, under the worst case, be lethal. So by extension, Jesus could have been talking about the mentally ill or mentally challenged individuals. Most likely it's all of the above. Quoting again from the scripture, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted, close quote. Most often, this verse is associated with those who have suffered the loss of a loved one, particularly a spouse or a child. But it can also be a parent, or just a significant other. But this can also mean those who have suffered catastrophic losses, like the survivors of hurricanes and wildfires and tornadoes who have nothing but the clothes they're wearing. They too, Christ has taught us, will be comforted, because they will regain much of what they have lost, if not all. Moreover, those who have lost loved ones will see them again, and maybe sooner than we all think. Only time will tell. Now, here's a little fact about the definition of being blessed and the definition of being not so blessed. Blessed are the meek, Christ taught us, for they will inherit the earth. Why? Because at some point in the fairly near future, all the warlike people of the world, of the entire planet, will kill each other off because of their addiction to fighting and conflict. They thrive on it. So let it consume them. The meek, the mild, the compassionate, the loving and gentle people, they will be the only ones left. Those whose only motivations are anger and rage will roast in hell if they do not repent of their angry attitudes. You all know who I mean. Blessed, said our Lord, are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled, close quote. Notice that it reads, for they will be filled. That means those who get filled with righteousness will derive theirs from God through his only Son, Jesus Christ. On the other hand, those whose righteousness is generated by their own human ego which is egocentric by nature and is derived from human emotions, are living in ways contrary to the teachings of Christ, whether they realize it or not. So let this be a wake-up call for those who are wrestling with these issues. There is a way out. It does get better. This is not going to be permanent for you. And here's another similar point. There will be no angry people in heaven, because Christ taught us, blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. In 21st century vernacular, it means to be forgiving and merciful towards others, because when you do, you get the same from them in return. Likewise, when we show mercy and kindness towards God's creations, other people, and even pets, we can expect the same from God. Conversely, on the other hand, the flip side, mean people, particularly those with violent tempers and who seem to be always angry, and those who commit violent crimes who do not repent of their violent behavior, should expect no mercy whatsoever from God when they stand before Him, when their time comes, and it is coming, unless they repent of their ways forever. There is still time. If you're watching this and you're on death row, you still have time, but make the move now. He's waiting for you, for God's sake. He's waiting on you with open arms. Blessed are the pure in heart, said our Lord, for they will see God. What does that mean? Well, since we all have a sinful nature that we all must work hard to control, for scripture on that, see Romans chapter 3, verses 9 through 18. People who are pure in heart are those who don't partake in the corrupt nature of the world in which we live. That is, it is not possible for any human being to keep his or her heart pure while they allow themselves to be surrounded by the gross impurities of this world. When I say gross impurities, I mean so in a spiritual sense. The time to get right with God is upon us all then. Let this be a wake-up call. Greed, malice, hate, prejudice, wall-to-wall sex all the time, pornography, every kind of addiction you can imagine, subliminal messaging and imagery designed to program the human mind are just a sampling of what's out there. All you Christians who look at porn, party at clubs all night, use dangerous drugs like heroin and meth, and so-called spice, which is allegedly artificial marijuana, but in actuality, it is neither. Those who do these things had better take a step or two away from what you're doing and from the person you have become, and take a good long look at yourselves. This is hard to hear, I know. But I deliver this message to you with the love of Jesus, not as a drill sergeant. I don't want to be anybody's drill sergeant. I'm a man of God, first and foremost. Take a good long look at yourselves. because you don't have much time left to get yourselves right with God. You know who you are. Please don't give up and walk away. One more paragraph, and I'm done. So, here we go with that. Thanks for sticking with me. Now, the flip side of the coin, to finish the thought, is that cursed are those who deprive humanity for profit. You'll recall from the quotation from 5 minutes ago, blessed are the peacemakers, Jesus taught us, for they will be called the sons of God. While this needs no explanation, it also says, cursed are the mercenaries who kill for profit, the politicians who send our sons and daughters off to fight and die in wars that benefit only a few people with their families, and of course, by extension, the military-industrial complex. Cursed are those. I'm not kidding. Hear me out. Cursed are those who pollute the earth that God created and who divert its resources exclusively for themselves, causing hardship and starvation for hundreds of millions. Cursed are they who deny electricity and clean drinking water to 25% of the planet so they can keep it all for themselves. Cursed are they, for they will be called the sons of the devil, the minions of Satan. On the other hand, Christ also taught us, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Meaning, all the Christians who have died or who will die for their faith fall into this category. So do all whistleblowers within government and industry, all of whom seem to die mysterious deaths under equally mysterious circumstances, which was not and is not a coincidence. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Presidents Kennedy and Lincoln, Attorney General Bobby Kennedy, as well as Malcolm X, all fall into this category. Persecuted for righteousness, to the point of being assassinated. I don't care if Malcolm X was Muslim. He had Christ in his heart and didn't, when he was alive and didn't even realize it. But he knows it now. Yeah, even him. That's right. The people you least expect. It's our job, people. It's our job as believers, then, to share our faith. Blessed are you, Christ taught us, when people insult you and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. If you have ever been cussed out, threatened, or physically attacked by Christian haters, you know the ones I mean. You know exactly what I mean. Now, what's the flip side of this one? Simple. If one has never had to defend one's faith, the depth of that one's belief is directly proportional to the vigor with which one is compelled to defend one's faith. Conversely, if we never talk to anyone about our faith and what Christ has done in our lives, our faith lacks depth, which limits how we interact with the risen spirit of the Christ the Lord. Never be afraid to talk to others about your faith. There's no need to do that. Because you never know when you can help someone. Oh, so that's why we do that. Okay, now we understand. Jesus has already saved your soul, hasn't he? But if not, please ask him right now. Please, please, please. Jesus, come live in my soul. He will. I kid you not. Try it. It really works. But to finish up here. The money power of faith. You can never be afraid, as I was saying, to talk to others about your faith, because you never know when you can help someone. You could even help lead a soul to their Savior, spelled with a capital S, of whom they were previously unaware. Jesus has already saved your soul, hasn't he? So go ahead and pay it forward. That's your job. And now let me briefly quote from Luke's Gospel as I close. Having riches diminishes in importance compared to following Christ. This is one of those deals. You already heard this before, but it needs to be said again. Having riches diminishes in importance when compared to following Christ. Why? Because in Luke's Gospel, Jesus said, "But woe to you who are rich, for you have already received your comfort. Woe to you who are well fed now, because you will go hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all men speak well of you, for that is how their fathers treated the false prophets." That came from Luke chapter 6, verses 24 through 26. So there you go, everybody. That sums up things rather nicely, don't you think? This is exactly what God's Word is saying to each and every one of us, spoken through His Son Jesus, or Yeshua in Hebrew, the native language of Christ. There are two sides to every teaching of Jesus, and sometimes more than that. This is just one of dozens of examples throughout the Bible where God's Word can mean more than one thing and still be consistent. In the meantime, and in closing here, everyone can please continue to pray for peace in our nation's schools, as well as in the Middle East, in Taiwan, on the Korean Peninsula, and especially peace in Ukraine. God forbid that any nuclear weapon be used in that war. May God forbid. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Shalom. Shalom. Normally at the end of the message in a brick and mortar church, this is the time where they pass around a collection basket. Well, I don't have a collection basket. One thing I will not do in traditional churches usually do, this is what one of the things that sets me apart. You will never hear me tell you that you have to tithe 10% of your income to this church. I never do that. I've already recorded a video in the past about why that's so. It's there in the archives. You can find it. But By the same token, I do this completely on a volunteer basis. I make no money from this. And all I've already got another income anyway, so I'm okay. But if you want to make a donation, it would be appreciated. All donations go directly to the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center of Atlanta, Georgia. You can contribute on, PayPal. Now, the email address for PayPal is as follows. It's greatestservant62@gmail.com. That's all one word, all lowercase. GreatestServant62@gmail.com. You can also donate on Stripe. To donate on Stripe, go to their homepage at stripe.com. Type in the search box Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center. It'll pop right up for you. Fill in the amount and send it on in. All donations are sincerely, sincerely appreciated. What do we need the money for if we don't have a building? Well, we don't need that much for one thing, but we do have expenses, rent, and things like office supplies. I'm trying to scrape together about $1,000 right now to finance a fairly basic marketing campaign. To get more people. You know, we exceeded 10,000 subscribers. Either subscribers or followers or friends and followers on social media. Adds up to over 10,000 people. Last count, I believe, was 10,400 and something. So this little ministry is going somewhere, and I want to thank each and every one of you for being a part of it, even if you've never sent in anything. You know, what's true? Those who don't have any money to send me any, I'm okay with that. I'm not here for money. I'm here because I'm trying to deliver souls to Jesus Christ. Not by my power, but by the power of Christ Jesus and His Holy Spirit that runs through me like an electrical current. It's the closest thing I can compare it to, is like an electrical current. So, now you know about that. But I never charge 10%. And I guess that's all for now. Please don't forget to give me a like and a share and a subscribe. Give it a like if you really liked it. No, even if you liked it some. Give me a share if you really liked it. And subscribe. It's free. You'll get these messages delivered to your inbox at least twice a week and sometimes more when I can find the time to record another one. And so, I guess that's all for now. I want to sincerely thank each and every one of you for the privilege of your time. You are all ever so much appreciated. And so, to conclude things, be blessed, everyone. Yes, I said be blessed. In Jesus' mighty name.